They also had, on August 22nd, a kindergarten popsicles on the playground, which was provided by the Mountain View PTO. And this is where kindergarten students and their parents got to go out on the playground, enjoy popsicles, and meet with their teachers, and stuff like that. Then on August 23rd and 24th was back to school nights. This is where parents and students were able to go out to the school and see the teachers ahead of time, the rooms, check any bus times or anything like that. And then on October 7th, there will be the Wellness Walk for Education, which is also provided by the Mountain View PTO. Okay, then Bagley Elementary School, they had a kindergarten open house on September 19th, or will have a kindergarten open house on September 19th. And they will have a sixth grade camp meeting on September 20th, which is information for the parents and students about sixth grade camp, which will also be held in the high school auditorium. There's also the art selection on September 23rd, where student representatives are able to go to the Latrobe Art Center and select artworks to bring back to their school for the students to vote on to add to their art collection. And then there's family skate night on September 26th and 27th, where students and their family members can go to the Latrobe Skating Center, and just enjoy some fun skating and good times. All right, then Latrobe Elementary School, they have on August 23rd and 24th their back to school night, where again, students and parents were able to go to the school before meet teachers, and classrooms and bus times, and they'll have their kindergarten open house on September 20th as well, and the Walk for Wellness will be held on October 7th during the day at the stadium. Are there any questions?
Yes, I do. The Walk for Wellness at Mountain View and LES are both on the 7th. Are they combined or are they separate walks?
They're separate walks.
Separate walks. Mm-hmm. Where is Mountain View going
to be? Mountain View does it through the neighborhood.
Oh, okay.
And back.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. Now here's Sammy Holsoffel with her report.
All right. I'm Sammy Holsoffel, and I'm the rep that will be, I'll be representing the junior and senior high. Beginning with the junior high, in light of the recent floods at Connellsville, the junior high was raising money for them. And on September 9th, they tallied $257 for the flood victims. They also held open house, or will hold open house, on Thursday, September 15th from 7 to 9 p.m. This will give parents the opportunity to visit their child's classrooms, go through their schedule, and see what their day is like. The Junior High German Club will be collecting donations to raise money for type 1 diabetes. When students donate money, they'll receive a shoe, like a shoe with a paper shoe, and they'll be able to decorate it And with all the sheets that they collect, they'll be making like a pack on the wall too for our Care for Diabetes. Then on this Friday at the football game, the band will be holding band night for the junior high students. So the children in band from the junior high will be able to play with the senior high marching band. And for the senior high, one of the biggest things is the freshman transition. So the freshmen will be coming up to the senior high, and 60 to 70% of their classes will be up there now. On the first day of school, which would have been Monday, August 30th, the freshmen and sophomores came to school that day and went through their schedules. They went through an orientation done by student council to help get them acquainted. And then on Tuesday, August 31st, the juniors and seniors began their first day. On September 8th, the senior high open house was held from 7 to 9 p.m. Parents were also, like the junior high, were given the opportunity to go through their student schedule and see everything that they were doing. The attendance for this was similar to previous years. Jocelyn's was also at the senior high. They were there for the seniors to purchase their caps, gowns, tassels, and other graduation supplies and merchandise. They were also there for underclassmen and seniors as well to purchase class rings, necklaces, bracelets, and other sorts of things. Homecoming. The homecoming parade will be September 30th at 5 o'clock. And following that, the broadcast will be taken on the Key Square at 7 o'clock. Changes to homecoming. The freshmen are now able to come. So we are expecting between 900 and 1,000 students to be attending, which is a lot more than previous years. Because of this increase in students, we're going to be having homecoming in the gym instead of in the commons area. The theme is going to be Hollywood red carpet. That's all I have for you. Any questions?
I do. Who thought band night was also for elementary students? Has that changed? Elementary doesn't participate.
It was years ago, but it is not anymore.
They've decided to do the side-by-side band, which they have found it has a greater effect on the band of the sixth graders.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Next, I'll turn it over to Mr. Maines, who's going to recognize the students.
Good evening, and thank you. I'm excited to have two of our students from the high school here this evening, Anna Hu and Yisha Liu, who both attended the Governor's School for Sciences this past summer at Carnegie Mellon University. And we're asking them to talk a little bit about the application procedure and their experiences they had at Carnegie Mellon. So I'm going to turn it over to them. So let's give them a round of applause. And congratulations.
As Mr. Main said, Asia and I attended the Pennsylvania Government School for the Sciences from the last week of June throughout the whole month of July at CMU. At PGSS, we attended 5 core courses, which were discrete mathematics, organic chemistry, the biotechnology of viruses, special relativity, and computer science. Sorry about that. Also, at this program, we were able to choose from a variety of electives, and each student was expected to participate in two or three electives. At this 5-week program, we spent a lot of our time in classes. Each day, we would spend about 4 hours in the classroom, and we were instructed by CMU professors and other local professors. Also, we were given free time at the end of the day, but most of us found ourselves doing homework that the professors had assigned us. So most of the time was, unfortunately, or for the better, doing work.
So in order to apply to Governor's School, we went through a fairly arduous process that involved around 400 people this year. So beginning around November, we would went on the website and printed out various sheets that we needed to fill out. These sheets included our information, a couple teacher's recommendations from both a science and math teacher, and also a recommendation from our guidance counselors. Our guidance counselor, Mrs. Hager, was great enough to have written two letters for both of us, and that was just a wonderful thing for her to do for us. After that process, we also wrote three essays describing why we wanted to go to Governor School and why we were interested in science as a whole. And after that, we also had to create a resume detailing our various academic and non-academic achievements and activities throughout the school year. After we sent all of this information to Carnegie Mellon, we waited around 3 or 4 months until around April, where we either accepted, where we were accepted or denied. Fortunately, either of us were denied. That's pretty optimistic. So during our time at TGSS, we also were involved in group research activities, which involved around 5 to 10 people per group. So these activities were based on the curriculum that we were studying, but it was an opportunity for each of us to sort of extend out into that specific field and to have some research knowledge behind it. So, for example, my group, we did physical chemistry, and we studied the properties of superconductors, or materials that can conduct electricity at zero resistance at very low temperatures. So each group wrote a 20 to 30 page paper detailing our research, data, and conclusions, and then they were presented at the very end in a science symposium presented by the students. The symposium was presented to both the students and staff and some representatives from the Pennsylvania House representative, I guess. Right. So we're going to pass around the papers later if you are interested in what we've done, but here's Anna to introduce her.
So during my time at Governor's School, I was involved in the biology labs, and my official title for my paper was The Effects of Common Substances on Neural Activity of Lumbricus terrestris, or the common earthworm. So, I know it sounds fancy. So me and 9 other people, during our 5 weeks there, we tested various substances on the neural activity of earthworms using either injections or long-term exposure. And the substances I tested were granulated sugar, saccharin, otherwise known as sweet and low, and honey. So during my research, we found that the granulated sugar, all three variables, resulted in more mucus being formed from the worms. And there was something actually interesting about the saccharin worms. After 3 days of chronic exposure, the worms developed like cyst-like bumps along their ventral nerve cord. And there's some pictures in there actually, but dissection too, and that was a lot of fun. But unfortunately, we ran out of time, and I wasn't able to dissect the cysts. And but maybe in the future I'll do that myself. But so from that, although we don't know what it is, there are a couple of factors that could have affected that. I concluded that it could have been just like something with the worm anatomy, where it wouldn't happen necessarily in humans, but just because of how worms are like made up, it just didn't cooperate well with their body. And other than that, the casualties weren't very high. unfortunately, one of the honey worms died after 3 days of exposure. The cause is not well known, but we think that it's just an overdose of honey, sugar. It just wasn't ready to take it. Another worm, unfortunately, was put under anesthetic and for too long, and it kind of died. Well, the number was pretty successful.
No, we didn't go home at all. However, our parents were allowed to visit us on the third week.
Okay. Was it as challenging as you thought it would be? More challenging or less challenging?
I thought it was a lot more challenging. The last summer I attended another program at Pitt, and it was labeled like the former Governor's School of Medicine. And compared to that, this program was much more rigorous, and I was just like surprised.
I heard they had Mrs. Pompili on call at home or something. They talked to us late night. Okay, once again, thank you. I just want to reemphasize one thing Nisha said. Over 400 plus applicants, 60 were chosen. We had two from Greater Latrobe, so I think that's quite an honor for these two students that we have. So congratulations to both of you.
Have instituted in the Greater Latrobe School District since our policy was enacted in 2012. It was reviewed in 2015, and since then there has been no other policy changes. The review of this policy was really prompted by a letter and a comment actually that was given to the board in May of the last school year, and it prompted us to really look at and review our programs in the district. And actually, we had to postpone it from last month because our principals weren't going to be able to be here because of an evening event at their schools. And so we're going to have many speakers this evening regarding this topic because it is so inclusive of a K-12 program. But we're going to start with Dr. Soltis, who is going to talk about the policy, its meaning, and so on. And then we're going to do a review K-6, 7 and 8, and 9 through 12 as far as the programs that we've implemented and do within each of those areas to hopefully educate our students on bullying, cyberbullying, its effects, and so on with regard to the policy. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Soltis to start, and then we're going to move to the K-6 program.
Good evening, members of the board and the community. I'm here to talk about the bullying program. So I'd like to start off with, this is from the board policy, and it is the definition that is provided to us by Pennsylvania's School Board Association and the state of Pennsylvania. This is legislated definition. And I have highlighted some particular words that I think are very important as we talk about bullying. The first one is that bullying is intentional. It doesn't happen by mistake. And it involves written and oral, and it involves electronic communications. It is considered to be, or it needs to be, either severe, persistent, or pervasive. And the bullying has one of three impacts. Either it interferes with the education of students, threatens the school environment, or substantially disrupts the school in some way. Now, for some students, bullying has been linked, or a student who is being bullied has been linked to things like truancy and poor grades. So it is an important, it is an important issue to deal with. It is fitting that we review our bullying program at this point, and I'm going to take you back in history. 6 years ago during the 2010-11 school year, my school psychology intern and I reviewed a number of bully programs. We developed a short list and wrote some pros and cons as we read through those different programs for each. And then we offered a training to faculty that they could attend and asked them to help us make the selection. They selected Bullyproof Your School program for a number of reasons, but some of the reasons had to do with, one, it was flexible, yet comprehensive. It was a K-12 articulated program. It had a strong emphasis on elementary lessons and was and is not, what is and what is not bullying. Talked about the good bystanders and reframed that as the caring community. Provided teachers with information on how to help students who are victims develop assertiveness skills. And it taught teachers how to support more vulnerable students. After we selected the program in August of 2012, then we launched the program. We presented to all of the faculty. Followed that, I met with groups of parents, PTOs, met with groups of teachers, the SAP team at the junior and senior high school, different building teams, and helping them work through the development of the curriculum. So it provides emphasis on the elementary lessons. So one of the things that I have learned over the years in my research and my study is that punishment in the traditional sense has very little impact on a student with the bullying behaviors. We try to differentiate between punishment and discipline, and the way I describe that is if you were disciplining someone, they would learn something from the discipline, whereas what I was taught originally about punishment is it's quick, painful, and forgotten. The key word there is forgotten. So once you pay your dues, you're free to go about and do what you had been doing before. Whereas discipline teaches new behaviors. So the emphasis of the program that we use, the Bullyproof Your Schools, teaches things to students who are both the victims or potential victims. I'd like to frame that as potential victims because if a student learns assertiveness skills, they have the skills to stand up to bullies. Our caring community is able to stand up to bullies. And on the other hand, when you have a student who is showing these bully behaviors, things that we try to teach them are to take a different frame of mind. We try to correct their thinking errors, and we try to teach them their skill deficits that they might be experiencing. I want to ask you a question. Does bullying happen in schools? Yes. Well, for that matter, does bullying happen in the community, in the world of work around us? So I'm getting some nods. Yes, it happens. The most important thing that we can share with our students is how do you cope with that sort of behavior from someone else, and how do we help the student who has the behavior overcome those skill deficits, correct their thinking difficulties. So the question is, what do? We address bullies with skill development and teaching, and we help victims develop assertiveness in order that they might no longer be victims. And many people have been bullied in their life, but not all of them develop the persona of being a victim. So I'm going to hand this over to our elementary team. they're going to talk about what they do at the elementary level that launches the learning about bullying.
Good evening. As the team of elementary principals present this evening, we will not only highlight the Bully Proof Your School curriculum, which is consistent across the three elementary schools that Dr. Soltis has spoken of, but we are also going to share with you a few of our special programs that we have in our schools that support that curriculum and those lessons. But I want you to know that our programs aren't just lessons given a few times a year. On a daily basis, each school participates in its own unique school-wide positive behavior support program. These programs truly become the culture of the school as well as the expectations. So I would like to introduce to you Mrs. Sherry Hodler, who is going to speak with you first about Bully Proof Your School.
As you have heard, we do have the curriculum called Bully Proof Your School, and it is in all three elementary buildings. And I just want to give you a focus of what that curriculum looks like. Pretty much the counselor oversees the program, but the unique piece is the classroom teachers actually teach the lessons. They're accountable for working with their own students and relaying all of the information and having those rich discussions with the kids. The second piece of this is the lessons contain many aspects. After they do the lessons, there are handouts that are completed and are taken home. But we truly believe that when we focus on bullying, that we have to hold hands with the families. We have to have a united front with school and family together. So after the lesson is taught, we send home parent letters as well as follow-up activities that the parents or guardians can do with their children when they're in the home. So they know exactly what the topic was for the day, what we did, and then how can they follow up at home. And then at the end of every unit, there is a parent survey. I need to take you through a few of the strategies, though, before I show you what happens in every grade level, because you may not understand if you don't see a couple of these slides. So to familiarize yourself with one of the strategies that we teach beginning in kindergarten, which is a little revised from the slide that you see, but there's a strategy called Ha Ha So, and it's a mnemonic device that helps the students remember what they can do in the event that they need to be intervening in a bully situation or if they're confronted with a situation. And it stands for how to help, how to assert yourself, where does humor come in, how to avoid, self-talk, what you can say to yourself, and then how they own that situation. So it's Ha Ha So. Some of us have posters up with this, but again, it's taught beginning in kindergarten at a revised level. Another strategy is another mnemonic device. It's called CARES. This is what we teach them as far as what they can do if someone is being bullied. And you can see what the letters represent as far as problem solving, getting an adult to help, joining in, having empathy, and standing up to speak. In fifth grade, we change to cyberbullying. So we take that CARES and we make it CARES for online. So how can students help themselves or help others if they're being bullied online? So we teach them how to do those aspects for connecting offline, saving what you have, reporting it, again, empathy, and the S stands for school, letting the school know what's going on. With that said, one of the most important slides we have is this slide right here. In schools and anywhere, you have normal peer conflict. Kids that just aren't getting along, friends that aren't talking to each other. And we try to teach the students what is normal peer conflict. We also provide this information to the parents. Something that is normal means that kids have equal power. They have been friends, or they're at the same level. It happens just every once in a while. And we'll ask the kids, how many times does it happen? Did it happen once, twice? That helps us determine what type of situation we're involved with. Was it an accidental situation? Not very serious? Are both kids feeling the same way? Are they both upset over what has occurred? Not trying to get something in return. If they care about what is happening and they want to solve the problem, we're really dealing with something that is age appropriate. And just we need to help them through the social piece of this. Versus a situation that is true bullying. Basically, there is an imbalance of power. Somebody's using their size or just their status to overcome someone. If it's something that's happening over and over again, and it's done on purpose, and it's very serious, if one of the people are feeling power, or they're doing it for power and control, and the bully doesn't care, and he or she does not want to solve that problem. This is such an important piece to what we do in an elementary school. And you will see that as we go forward, as I show you the lessons. The next slide, kindergarten through sixth grade, I'll just take you through a cycle that will show you the topics that we deal with in each grade. You will see that there's pictures of books there. We do have a literature-based program in elementary school. We have a lot of stories that we use with the kids, where the kids can relate to the characters, and that way we can have a lot of discussion. We also use videos, we use YouTube, where they can see things happening, we can role play. You will see in kindergarten and first grade, the topics are listed on your screen, they are the same. There is never mention of a bully in kindergarten or first grade. We really talk about friendship. What is a friend? How do you join a group? Many kids don't even know how to become part of a group at recess or if somebody's in station work. So we do a lot of work with that. When do you tell a teacher and when do you work it out? What is tattling versus telling? So that is all focused using those books there. First grade has the same type of focus as far as friends go. Because they're in first grade, we will talk a lot about old friends versus new friends, because they would have had friends last year and now they have new friends this year. Again, we spend time how to join a group. We also begin talking about conflict with the parents. We'll provide information to them. Again, going back to that screen I showed you earlier. But you have to realize that first graders are just learning their social skills. And they are selfish at times. They want their own way at times. They love to tattle. They may not want to play with someone, but that doesn't mean they're bullying. They just need help developing socially. So that is the focus in plan one. When we move to second grade, you are going to see that is where we will start talking about a bully. Again, we will talk about conflict versus bullying, friendship versus kindness. We will also introduce the ha-ha-sos and the cares, and we'll do a lot of role-playing so that they can relate to victims as well as being a helper. Third and fourth grade have the same topics. We will use different literature. We'll dig in a little bit deeper. In third grade, we will talk to them and spend a lot of time on evaluating a one-time event versus bullying. Again, tattling versus telling. It may sound silly to you, but it's such an important component to our program. And we also talk to them about being assertive using ha-ha-so. How can you use those concepts to really truly intervene to help out and so that you do not become a victim, as well as the cares strategy. In fourth grade, again, you're going to see the concepts are the same. We really start talking about name calling at this grade, you know, what that means and how it makes people feel. Again, conflict versus bullying and making decisions based on the ha-ha so strategy and cares. As I said earlier, fifth grade turns to cyberbullying. And the concepts for the cyberbullying program are listed on your screen. We take a lot of time and talk to them about what is just for fun versus cyberbullying. Because everything kids post is not necessarily bullying. They do think it's funny, but they don't realize how it affects the people on the other side. So we do spend a lot of time on that, as well as using the ha-ha so to stop the cyberbullying. In grade six, the same concepts are taught. At this level, we start giving them statistics on bullying, where they can actually see numbers and how people are affected. We continue the conflict versus bullying. We also use YouTube videos. One of them is what happens if you're charged as a bully? Where does that go? When do the police get involved? They do watch a lot of videos determining how to implement the ha-ha so strategies as well as cares. And one of the culminating projects for sixth grade is to create presentations to promote a bully-free school, and they will share those with grades 2, 3, and 4. Our next presenter is Mrs. Stewart.
The elementary schools have numerous special programs that we bring into the schools that support the Bully Proof Your School curriculum and help us stomp out bullying. One of the programs that we do have is the Blackburn Center Bullying Harassment Program. Representatives from the Blackburn Center come into the school to present lessons that mimic the Bully Proof Your School program. Each lesson involves an introduction to the grade-specific topic that you can see on the slide, followed by a literature connection, videos, role-playing, or some similar activity, and ends with, again, a handout that the students complete and take home to share with their families. As you can see, the younger students learn about what bullying is and what to do if you are being bullied or see someone being bullied. The older students learn about what a frenemy is and how to get out of a frenemy relationship, and about harassment and how that connects to social bullying. Moving into October, we will support the National Bully Prevention Month, which is in October. On a daily basis, students will hear on the announcements tips about bullying. For example, students may hear this tip one day. What is popular is not always right. What is right is not always popular. Take responsibility for your actions and always do what is right, even if that right is not popular. Decide to stop bullying and instead tell people you care. If you stop hanging out with other bullies, this may not be the popular choice, but it's the right choice. So that's one tip that they may hear throughout the month. We will also share tips on if you are being bullied, reminding students that it's not their fault. No one deserves to be bullied, and ask for help. And by asking for help, that is not tattling. It is the right thing to do. We also address the student who may realize that they are bullying others. And we encourage them to find the help of an adult in the building, or at home, or somewhere in the community, to help stop being a bully and become a better friend. We also address the cyberbullying, and we teach the students to save the evidence and show it to an adult as soon as possible, so that the adult can help stop the bullying. So as the month goes on, they will receive these tips on a daily basis. Also, on October 3rd this year, is World Day of Bullying Prevention, where on this day, we will ask everyone to wear a blue shirt and join us in solidarity to stop bullying and cyberbullying. And now we have Mrs. Becky Pellis to talk with you about our school-wide positive behavior program.
As Mrs. Stewart mentioned earlier, all three elementary schools, both the junior high and high school, we all have school-wide positive behavior support programs within our buildings. That does become our culture of the building. Even though each of our cultures might be a little bit different and what we call it might be different, the same goal is consistent through all the buildings. So it's a school-wide system that supports and includes proactive strategies for defining, teaching, and supporting appropriate student behaviors to create a positive school environment that we strive for every day at Greater Latrobe. Here at the bottom, you're going to see a punch card that's from LES, and I'm going to talk about LESs here in a moment. You see a bulletin board from Mountain View from their Caring Cats, and you also see how full is your bucket, which is part of the bucket brigade at Bagley Elementary School. First here is BES, so Bagley's school-wide positive behavior support program. It's called a bucket brigade. They focus on a positive character trait throughout the month. They recognize this monthly with a student in each homeroom that exemplifies that trait. And within that, they have a monthly lunch with Mrs. Swigert, our superintendent, so that they're able to share the great things that are happening at Bagley Elementary School. At LES, their school-wide positive behavior support program is called Wildcat Roars. Roars standing for respect others, observe safety rules, act responsibly, reach for success, and show kindness. Through this, they get CATS cash, which is the punch card that you saw earlier. As they are following through with roars, they get punches. They earn rewards by accumulating so many punches. If you're at the 100% club, you get your picture taken, name on a poster, and again, there's that monthly lunch with Mrs. Swigert. And finally, at Mountain View Elementary School, our program is called Caring CATS. CATS standing for caring and taking a stand. It is our positive character trait each month. There's a word that we focus in on, and throughout that month, the homeroom teachers will determine one student in each homeroom that exemplifies that positive character trait. Again, they meet once a month with Mrs. Swigert to talk about the great things that are happening in Mountain View and why they are chosen as that month's caring cat. Also, throughout the building, we have classroom caring cats, which shows the entire classroom is following through with the school-wide positive behavior support, and so they're able to achieve different cat paws, and each quarter, the homeroom is rewarded for having the most cat paws on their door. Now it is time to hear from our secondary program, I believe, starting with Mr. Schibitz.
Good evening. Thank you, and I will begin the secondary program. And as you can see, we have five principals spanning grades 7 through 12. And so I will be speaking on behalf of grades 7 and 8. But just to sort of kick off the second part of this presentation, I think that we all sort of stand with a consistent message of what you just heard from the elementary school. Obviously, what a litany of education they provide to our students as they enter junior high school and they enter their high school years. And really, if you think about, we don't want to reinvent the wheel, per se. We want to make sure that we continue that consistent message. We want to keep consistent with the education that we're providing our students. But I like to say that we also like to put in action at this point. As students enter that seventh grade year, and this is my first year as a 7-8 principal. What I've learned in the first few weeks of school here, and just what a wonderful group of children we have, how impressionable they are in the junior high school, how impressionable they are with the groups of friends they make, how impressionable they are with things they see on social media, how impressionable they are when they see their classroom teachers, how they treat each other, how they're acting, how we're acting as principals when we're speaking to them in different situations. And so we want to just be able to continue that consistent message, but we also want to be able to lead by example, and we also want to put them in situations that empower them. And so if that means talking with our student council, if that means I know that we all sort of adopt the philosophy of take care of each other, And we preach that to our students all the time. We want to see our students the first day of school, and we challenge them. If you see somebody sitting alone in the cafeteria, what are you doing about it? Who's going to be the student who stands up for what's right and invites that student over to sit at their table? Or if somebody's being picked on, who's going to stand up and who's going to come to the principal's office and tell us that? Who's going to understand that that's not tattling, that that's being a good person, that that's character, and that's standing up for what's right, and that we try to give them the tools necessary. A lot of students, you know, in elementary, as they're coming to junior high, are scared of our office, in a sense, and we want to make sure we understand it, or they understand that it's an open-door philosophy. They can come in here, and we're here to help, and they have to join us in this process of eliminating bullying from our schools. If you look at the second bullet, you're going to hear that a lot tonight, the caring community that we're trying to put in place, and that's from the teachers, that's from the students, and that's from all of these programs that you're going to see here in a second. And then school-wide positive behavior supports. What are we doing to show our students and showcase our students that are doing things great every single day? And I'm proud to be an alumni of Greater Latrobe. We have 95% of our students are doing fantastic things. They're treating people with respect every single day. And we try to make sure that we have supports in place to showcase those students and use those students, in a sense, to be an example for their peers. And hopefully that's a contagious experience. A few things, and I'm kind of speaking on behalf of the junior and senior high school here. Grades 7 through 12, all of our teachers went through three different trainings over the past few years. And as you can see, they're transgender, suicide awareness, and racial sensitivity training. And obviously, sensitive topics, in a sense, topics that, you know, statistics have proven who can be pinpointed with students struggling with bullying. But we also wanted to make sure that within those trainings, we gave our teachers some empowerment that they, and I will tell you, sitting in there, they were able to see some things that I think opened their eyes a little bit. They were able to put themselves in the shoes of some students, some different populations of students, some different groupings of students, and were able to take that back to the classroom. It generated some fantastic discussion. How can we relate to those students? How can we mentor those students? And they came up with things on their own as far as creating mentoring programs, teachers taking students under their wing, certain safe zones in the school for students to be able to report to. So again, each one of those trainings were for our staff to enhance their own knowledge and put some more tools in their toolbox to go forward. And some common programs, 7 through 12, you'll hear the high school repeat this, but we have a student assistance program in both buildings. And what that is a group of teachers, principals, counselors, a school nurse, as well as community liaisons too, where teachers can make referrals. If they're seeing some at-risk behavior, could be academic, could be behavior, could be something reported to them, we can bring those students up in a confidential meeting, and we can then begin the process of monitoring those students, sending out a survey of sorts, which has their teachers monitor what are they doing in class, are we seeing consistent behavior, and then we would obviously contact the parents, we let them know and be as transparent as possible, and offer them supports. We have supports within the school that the student assistance program can establish, as well as liaisons outside of school that we can set up with out-of-school counseling that you will hear further. Second, we've been joined with the Westmoreland Drug and Alcohol Grant over the past, I believe it's 3 years now, who have provided us with some wonderful guest speakers. And they do that twice a year, it seems, in October with Bullying Month, and we do Red Ribbon Month, and also around the end of the year, May. And drug and alcohol, I know this is a bullying presentation, but it really goes hand in hand. We talk about peer influences, we talk about character, we talk about peer pressure and things that these students will face. And they've been actually able to provide us with some guest speakers from outside and around the country to come in and speak to our students in a large audience and really connect with them. And then you'll hear Common Program 7 through 12 is our health curriculum. All students in the secondary take health in 8th grade as well as online in the senior high school. So they're getting that twice. And on both instances, talking to Mr. Varinsky, who's the health teacher at the junior high school, they're going through all of these things that were mentioned earlier by elementary. Coping skills, talking about the difference between conflict and bullying, talking about how to reach out. He actually has students create packets of local organizations that they can go to, because some students just aren't comfortable coming to the school. Some students want to come in here and get out. And he actually has a brochure that they actually go out and research different avenues that hopefully they can take with them for the rest of their life and actually know what's available in the community. So it's a really good example of what we're doing in the health curriculum. So Mrs. DeCastello, the assistant principal of grades 7 through 9, is going to highlight some specific programs in the junior high school.
Good evening. Okay, so we have a number of different programs at our junior high. What both Mr. Shibitz and I have found is that peer interaction is going to be a huge part of our job this year. We have certainly found that a lot of our students have some amazing skills coming out of our elementary program. We have a lot of students sticking up for other students. We have a lot of students exhibiting a lot of positive behaviors, but we still have students struggling. Okay, we're going to be working with those students one-on-one as much as we can, but we have a number of programs in place to help these students and also to help the bullies and help the victims as well. Okay, one of those programs is the St. Vincent Prevention Projects. They actually push into our classroom. In our seventh grade history lessons, they come in and they do a program called Project Alert. These are research-based programs that are effective for this age level. All seventh graders get to see this in their history class when they cover programs or information like conflict resolution, okay, violent behaviors, bullying behaviors. So they talk about a number of things in these history classes throughout the year. And again, they're research-based programs. In the eighth grade health classrooms, we then have St. Vincent Prevention Projects come back and do what is called a Project Alert Booster, where they come into the classroom for three sessions for all eighth grade students to discuss similar ideas, similar topics. St. Vincent Prevention Projects also sends counselors into our building, and they develop support groups. And these are amazing experiences for groups, for at-risk groups. We'll have 6 to 8 week sessions of targeted students that have either been involved or that in some way been a part of a number of different negative peer interactions, such as bullying or cyberbullying, or struggling to fit in, or struggling just simply with their social skills in different aspects of their school career and their community career. So St. Vincent comes into our school through a number of different programs and is able to work with our students and help them with all of these different social skills, including bullying. Our junior high counselors also do an amazing job through a number of structured programs. Transition Camp is a program that we offer to our at-risk students. Those students are identified at the elementary level and coming into seventh grade. Students that may struggle with the transition from the sixth grade classroom to the junior high building. Things change significantly from elementary to junior high school. And a lot of the students that may have issues with that transition are identified and invited to a transition camp. A large part of that transition camp is one, making friends from all of the different buildings, meeting new kids, and discussing normal conflict versus bullying. Extremely important for these at-risk youth that are going to feel extremely vulnerable when they set foot into that junior high. So it's a really, really nice program. We also have a lot of fun. I know that I got blasted with a water balloon during this year's transition camp, right in the face, all down the front. It was very, very fun for actually the administrators as well to get to meet that group of students. So it was a great opportunity for that. Our counselors also go into the classrooms, and they complete a number of lessons, some of which deal with bullying. They also introduce our students to their services, which is an amazing opportunity for our students. We talked this summer and realized that a number of us as administrators, when we were in high school, didn't know our guidance counselors. We didn't know them. We didn't know who they were when we were in high school. I had no idea. Mine helped me with the college application, but I had no idea. So So we're starting a program here and continuing to get our counselors out into our classrooms so all of our kids know these counselors, feel comfortable with the counselors, and the counselors are providing services right in the classroom as well. Our counselors then look for need and develop targeted small group discussions where they'll bring, again, at-risk students for a particular issue together, and they'll discuss that. They'll have small group counseling sessions with those students. So our counselors are doing amazing things every day for our students, both programmatically, but also just individually with the students. A few other things that our teachers and counselors do. One you've heard from the elementary about their positive behavior support system. Right now, Mr. Shivitz and I, along with a group of teachers and counselors, are developing a program for the junior high school. We plan to incorporate all of those character aspects that are included in the elementary program, filling the bucket program, the caring cats program, along with a few more mature, more junior high-like character ideas. So we're really excited to develop this program. Mr. Shivitz and I could have sat down over the summer to develop it on our own. We did wait. We wanted the input from our teachers. Our teachers are going to be an extremely important aspect of this program. If they don't understand this program, they're not going to participate in this program, and it's not going to be a successful program. So currently, we have some really solid ideas, and we plan to have this program in place late September, early October. We're going to continue to reinforce the positive behaviors that our students exhibit. Okay? So we're very excited. Hopefully, we'll have an update on that soon. Our counselors, along with our teachers and our student council, also developed a new student breakfast, where any student that is new to the district is actually invited to a breakfast where they'll meet student council members, they'll meet teachers, the counselors and the administrators will also be present. And it's an opportunity to make those new students feel at home, to make them feel less susceptible to these bullying style behaviors. Our social studies classes, our history classes, are also required to review our handbook. And part of that review is reviewing the bullying policy, the board bullying policy. And the seventh grade team does a lot of that. One thing that I want to discuss is most of what we have up here are school-wide structure programs. But what we have seen from our teachers is absolutely amazing. They saw a need with one of the classes, I believe it was last year's class, for continued character development. On their own, they developed a number of different lessons, a number of different posters, and they actually have started to hang those in the walls. There's no structured program, there's no reward, it's simply our teachers caring about our kids, and again, leading by example, saying, this is really important. We're going to make this part of our everyday school community. We're going to talk about this, we're going to resolve conflict, and we're going to move forward. So I just have to say that I've been working with these teachers for 3 to 4 weeks, and I am unbelievably impressed by what they do with the students in various different aspects, but especially in the aspect of character development and dealing with negative peer interaction. Very, very impressed. At this point, I'm going to turn it back over to Mr. Shivitz, and he's going to talk a little bit about the administrative side of bullying. Thank you.
Sure, and I will just conclude here, and I just have a slide to go before we turn it over to the senior high school, but I second what Mrs. DeCastello said. If you notice the last few slides, the amount of time these things take, the amount of time that character education takes in the classroom, or our social studies classrooms, or different push-ins to various things, but we value that, and our teachers value that, and we allow for that time, and you think of the job they have to do with the Common Core and the standards and everything that they're doing to teach the curriculum, but really buying into this and making sure that this is at the forefront. And I second what she said. Boy, I'll tell you what, I've seen some people in my first few weeks, they're really rolling up their sleeves and they're just communicating back and forth. Watch this lunch table, watch this group of students, and really advocating to make sure that everybody feels comfortable. Is it ever going to be 100%? I sure hope so. But it's definitely an uphill battle, but we have a group of teachers that are just doing a great job looking at that. So just to go off of what she said, the administrative disciplinary response, I enjoyed what Dr. Stoltis mentioned earlier. You know, we could talk here, it would be an easy job if I could wipe my hands clean every day and I simply hand out a detention or an in-school and that fixes the problem of bullying, but it's proven that that doesn't do it. You know, a lot of these students, we need to incorporate their parents at home, we need to get them supports in the school, we need to get them adults in the school that they can relate to, that can take them under their wing. And so we really want to, and I believe the elementary school said it, have a unified approach with the school and parents. We want to make sure that whether the student is the victim, whether the student is the aggressor, that we're being as transparent as possible. And yes, we're going to be consistent. We're going to try to be as no tolerance as possible, but we know that everything's not black and white. There's all kinds of different things that come into different situations. And we want to make sure what we can do comprehensively is make sure we let parents know what's going on and we let our teachers and our counselors know so that we can follow up with that student and make sure that they have all of the tools necessary to cope with these things that they're facing. If we go to the last slide, just looking ahead with the junior high, Mrs. DeCastello mentioned we want to grow our school-wide positive behavior support program. So we are about to roll that out shortly. We have things going like an ice cream social are being mentioned and different things that would incorporate parents coming into the building as well as teachers recommending these students for all sorts of reasons, may I add. Not just for academic success, not just for character things, but looking at students who might not be recognized otherwise. And possibly empower them to feel a part of this community and make sure that they're doing appropriate things. The second bullet, I want to take my hat off to these four people here who have done a wonderful job discussing programs with our junior high school and our ninth graders on social media and technology interactions. Officer Dare and Dr. Pinus did a wonderful job, and I know Mr. Krellick is going to talk about at the beginning of the school year with our orientation, to talk about what's going on online, to talk about appropriate social media consequences, also problems that people are facing, and Officer Dare was there to talk about the law enforcement side and how powerful that was for students to hear. He pulled out some technology that sort of blew your mind about what people can see, and if people like us can see that, imagine what the police officers can see. And how he drove that home was just a fantastic thing for our students to witness. And also Mr. Perenka and Mr. Krellick did a program last year, I think, for all seventh graders entitled Your Words Matter, and went into seventh grade classes and discussed different examples in our society of students that our kids could relate to, saying things online, consequences that resulted in that, and some really current issue things that were just extremely powerful and really hit home for our students. So we can talk about the definitions of bullying, but really using examples and getting down to their level on social media and showing them real life things is extremely important. And moving forward, we talked about surveying our faculty and having a questionnaire on bullying followed by monthly mini faculty lessons. So on the first slide, I talked about all the trainings our teachers are going through. We want to continue that. We don't want that to be a one-and-done thing. We want them to continue to think about best practices and how we can best reach these students. And we're also throwing around here in the future a 40 developmental asset survey for all seventh grade students. And to kind of get back to our core and back to our roots of showing students what are the character traits, what does it take to have developmental assets and be a successful citizen, have successful character moving forward. And we want to be able to track those students and see where they come in seventh grade and possibly where they end at in high school or beyond, and see where we can create our programs in a better light and better format for our students. So without any further ado, I know Mr. Krellick is jumping at the bit to get up here. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Shippens. Mrs. DeCastello mentioned the utilization of the St. Vincent prevention programs. We are very excited at the high school to continue this valued program with the new, relevant, and age-appropriate topics at the senior high school for the very first time. Recently, I had an opportunity to sit down with Mr. Greg Norton, who is a recently retired Pennsylvania State Trooper who work primarily in the narcotics division for the state police. With his wealth of knowledge and experience and background, I am thrilled that Mr. Norton has been hired by the St. Vincent Prevention Programs, and he will be delivering these programs directly to our students at the senior high school grades 9 through 12. The first program that Mr. Norton will be delivering is called Too Good for Drugs, which all ninth grade students in their physical education and health classes will receive in 10 sessions. This program focuses on peer pressures and peer influences and has been delivered to our ninth grade in previous years. But with Mr. Norton presenting, we anticipate this program being adjusted and appropriate for the students in grade 9. Other programs that we have that will be new for this year is in grade 10, 11, and 12, four sessions each, with grade 10 focusing on peer conflict and drug abuse, grade 11, over-the-counter medicines and underage drinking, and grade 12, drug-free workplace and graduation expectations. Again, we are thrilled to be extending our partnership with St. Vincent College prevention programs, knowing that drug usage and abuse oftentimes enters young people's lives when they feel desperate for acceptance by their peers or fail to have the necessary support system in their life and are vulnerable to at-risk behaviors. The next thing I would like to talk about, and our junior high administrators talk a little bit about it as well, deals with the concept of transition. We've really been focusing on transition the last several years, talking about transition from the elementary school to the junior high, but we haven't done a whole lot with transition from junior high to senior high, which can be equally as challenging for students as well. You may have heard, or you may not have heard, that the first day of school was quite unique here at the secondary level. We had a discussion sometime in July about the changes that were going to take place here in the senior high, and our discussion led to the fact that we're going to have 675 students in the senior high for the very first time that have never been in this building. That's quite a difference to having only one class being sophomores here. So with both the freshmen and the sophomores being in the senior high for the first time, we thought we had it a little bit different than what we've done in previous years. In previous years, we held an orientation for 10th grade, typically around the second week, third week of August. It was a week before the teachers arrived, and we had a fairly good attendance. About 75% of our students would attend 10th grade orientation. But that still leaves you 50 plus students that aren't there, who show up on the first day of school, that don't have their schedules, they don't know where they're going, and so on. So thinking about having both the freshmen and the sophomores and having a traditional orientation, we thought that would not be the correct course of action. So we decided to do something different. We made August 29th, the first day of school on our calendar, a day for the freshmen and sophomores solely, that we could focus all of our attention on them. Consequently, from our juniors and seniors who had an extra vacation day, we didn't receive one complaint from them about this change. They were okay with that. But going into this day, you know, we went into it with a little bit of anxiety, not knowing what it would look like. But by the end of the day, we all sat down and agreed that it was probably the most valuable time we could have spent with our freshmen and sophomores acclimating them to this building in the senior high. During this day, we invited all of our students, our 9th and 10th grade students, along with our entire faculty, to work together. And we had several different presentations that were going on that day. We had a bullying presentation, and this was put on by Mr. Premka, who was very busy doing this presentation, along with Ms. Jessica Scapora, who is our global studies teacher for 11th grade. We talked to students about their words mattering, very similar to what we did with the 7th grade, but adjusted for that audience being 9th and 10th graders. We also had a social media awareness presentation, and this was presentation was delivered by Dr. Pinus and Officer Rob Dare, our school resource officer, with a focus on cyberbullying and sexting, which is a very important topic that students need to be aware of, and certainly need to be aware of the consequences that could follow if they are participating in some of those adverse behaviors. Ms. Jillian Malloy was able to provide a picnic lunch for our 9th and 10th grade students outside the courtyard, just welcoming that day as well. So it was a very welcoming day for our students and very relaxed and getting them acclimated to the building. But the highlight of our day was probably the building tours, which was put on by our student council, was delivered by our student council, who came to our building and broke in small groups, and they took small groups around the building and toured the entire senior high complex and wore their shirts. They wore orange shirts that said we are all in this together. And I can tell you that, you know, it's always an eye-opening experience for us. Whenever students hear from other students, it is much more meaningful as opposed to hearing from adults. And they were asking questions during these tours, they were smiling, they were enjoying their time with the student council, and it really seemed to have a strong impact. And I will tell you again, at the end of the day, we sat back and said, that was probably the best thing we could do, just bring the freshmen and sophomores in for that one day of just giving them a walkthrough, if you will. Because when they came to school on the 30th, the 675 new faces, they knew where they were going. They felt confident coming to the senior high. They felt confident and excited to go and meet their teachers. They knew what they were doing, and it was a great way to transition them into the senior high. So we're hoping that will certainly translate into our students feeling comfortable here and willing to meet the challenges ahead. Here's our student council, EWCTC students, some EWCTC students, and other members of the high school student body leading or dressed in their safety orange shirts that say we are all in this together on the backside. So, and as Mr. Collins said, this was the highlight of the day. As these tours were going on, students were giving tips, tricks of the trade throughout the building, talking about what you can get away with one teacher, what you can't get away with another teacher. All good conversation, and it's all about building that positive school culture and really engaging these freshmen and welcoming freshmen and sophomores and welcoming them into that high school. Okay, this is a tweet. Yes, I am on Twitter, and I told the 11th and 12th grade students that on the very first day. I got a pretty good chuckle out of that. They found out to be pretty comical that I am on Twitter. I read a tweet this summer from an 11th grade student that said, I would rather move to Antarctica and live with the penguins than go back to school. Combine that with another article that I read that, you know, pretty much talked about how high school school engagement among high school students is at an ultimate low right now. So we talked administratively, and we said, what can we do? Kids come to school on the first day full of energy, full of enthusiasm. How do we capture that energy and enthusiasm so that kids want to be in our building? So we met with our teachers on the second day of in-service and asked them to think outside of the box for their lesson plans on day one. Kids do not want to come to school and sit through 8 periods of syllabus and rules. Okay? They don't want to hear what they can't do. They want to hear about what they can do and opportunities that they have in this building. And that's really what we focused on. And you can read the tweet from Mike Linson, who is a veteran teacher, 25 years experience, and an author of 5 or 6 books. Basically saying, we want kids running out of these doors, running up, telling their parents, hey, I have the best teacher, I love my classes, I want to be in school. That's really what we were focusing on. And here's 2 pictures. A lot of teachers did participate in this. This is one example, Mrs. Suter's chemistry class. Students were making ice cream, and as the kids were making ice cream, she was talking about the different chemical reactions that were taking place. So really, we're focusing on building that positive school culture and really engaging students in school. And I talked about being on Twitter. I think it's important, and I told students on day one, follow me. I'm posting a lot of good things that are happening throughout the high school on a daily basis. I think it's important for kids at this age to have positive role models that they are following, because a lot of people out there to follow are probably not the best influence for them. So I think it's great that for students to have these positive influences. So we're trying to do our part just by posting. These pictures were posted on my Twitter account. I'll be posting the picture from Anna and Visha at tonight's board meeting on there as well. So a lot of good things happening in the high school. Follow me, JMeets16 on Twitter. Next over to Mr. Engel.
Good evening. I'm going to talk about a few of the programs that we have in place at the high school that recognize and build a school community that's positive and a culture that's positive. These programs address self-esteem and interventions for social and emotional and academic issues. The first one that many people recognize is Breakfast of Champions. And Breakfast of Champions, of course, you know, is probably one of our most popular social and programs that we have in place. And, you know, each month, faculty members choose a student who is recognized because they've shown improvement or they've shown growth, a change in attitude. And so we tell the teachers, choose these students based on your 40 developmental assets, and don't always choose that student that has a 4.0 and is the star of the classroom. We're going to choose those students and identify and recognize positive changes that those students have made in the classroom. And so we have that breakfast every month, and of course we have parents and students and counselors, teachers, administration, we have board members that show up every month as well. And the program recognizes those students that have made a positive change, and we believe that it really continues to build a positive culture in our building and a caring school community. Mr. Shibbs mentioned the student assistance program. And just to elaborate a little bit, that is a collaboration between SPHS, Westmoreland County Mental Health Services, Westmoreland Drug and Alcohol Commission, and school districts in Westmoreland County. SAP basically identifies students who are struggling with life stressors, dealing with social and emotional issues. And we recognize those students. We help parents identify those problems that students may be having, and we give parents the tools within the school and in the community to help deal with those problems that students may be having. Our academic resource team consists of teachers, counselors, and administration that identify students who are having academic struggles. And these students meet with their designated advisors and work through areas of current concern and follow through with any needs that students may have. Very simply, team members will help students setting up times to get into the tutoring center, connecting them with math or language labs teachers, or simply helping them to be organized with their studies. And we help those students work through those issues. For seniors, it's a little bit more intensive. Those that are struggling with a particular class that they may meet, we may meet with seniors two or three times a week towards the close of school in order to make sure that they're doing what they need to do in order to walk across that stage and get a diploma. The next is our mentoring program, and this is kind of changing a little bit. In the past, it has consisted of teachers, counselors, and administrators that meet to discuss students that are struggling socially or emotionally. We would talk about these students and we would try and get them a little bit of help and try to put them in the right direction with people that they maybe can make connections with. Moving forward with the influx of our career pathways, we see using the 40 developmental assets survey and using that to identify students who may be struggling socially, emotionally, and getting those students that extra help. We also see this survey as a way to identify and keep track of students that have not connected with a teacher or a counselor, and putting those people in the right places to connect with those students and mentor them. Simply put, it's a process of survey those students, identify the students, connect, meet, and then mentor them. Career pathways, we've talked a lot about career pathways, and really career pathways is a link to the student's future. Students choose their career pathways to continue throughout their high school career to explore and develop interests that will expose them to careers within their career cluster. And maybe they don't necessarily know exactly what career they want to go into, but they may eliminate careers that they know they don't want to go into, and that is just as important. They choose that career pathway. It not only allows those students to have meaningful input into the courses that they take, but it also allows those students to take ownership of their education. And when you have ownership of your education, you're making relevant choices, it becomes a positive learning experience, and school becomes important to them. And finally, the last program that we have is our Remembering Adam Volunteer Drug Testing Program. This is the third year that we've had this program. And consistently, we have about 100 students that sign up every year and voluntarily sign up to take a drug test. And it's random. We may test two or three students a week. We call them down and they pick out of a hat a number, and that number corresponds with a different type of test that they may take. And those students use that on college applications. They use it on resumes. They use it on job applications. And they'll tell you. Those students are proud to be part of that program, and they'll tell you that they're in that program. And really what it does is twofold. It's a resume builder, and it's also a way for students to say, no, I'm in the drug testing program, and it's a peer pressure thing. They can say no, and they have an excuse why they get put in that situation. So students are using that really in a good way. All of these programs help to build an environment that is conducive to a positive educational experience, as well as building that caring community that we've talked about.
So what are we doing for 2016, for the 2016-2017 school year? We had over 30 students attend Pennsylvania Free Enterprise Week this past summer. At Pennsylvania Free Enterprise Week, Sweethearts and Heroes is a bullying presentation. We had two students come back and say, Thomas Ringo and myself, that, hey, we have to get this presentation in here. It's a MMA fighter, it's a wrestler, it's a veteran that fought in the Iraq War that was disfigured. They did an outstanding job, according to the students. Mr. Ringo and I have been in contact with them. We're looking at bringing them to the high school sometime in November or in January, whatever we can make work with their schedule and with ours. But they really focus on victim bullying and bystanders, empowering bystanders to make a difference. And this is all part of being part of that caring community. In the afternoon, they really focus on working small group sessions with student council. It could be sports groups, whoever we choose, but they want a small group to really drive this point home with them. We're also starting a Leader Academy this year at the high school, which is sponsored by Chick-fil-A. These Leader Academies engage students in monthly leader labs. Our kickoff, our event kickoff, is on Tuesday at 7:15 here in the CSC. Kids are going to be boxing about 900 meals, which is all part of the kit that was shipped to us, and we'll be donating these meals to food banks within our community. Throughout these leader labs, we focus on important leadership skills, and students will use these leadership skills to lead or create a student-led community impact project in April. And one example of a project that was given to us was a senior citizen crawl. So it's something where they'll have to raise money to support this community project for whichever they choose. We also been talking about the Boomerang Project, which is another transition program. It's the link crew that we'll be focusing on for the high school. And you can see it starts out with that high school orientation, really welcoming the freshmen into the building. Then it's all about building the relationships throughout the year with academic follow-ups, social follow-ups, and those different leader-initiated contacts. We will be sending an administrator and probably a counselor to get trained sometime early next year, and we'll get that started through the 2017-2018 school year. That pretty much ends the high school presentation. I will now turn it back over to Dr. Soltis.
I'd like we met on Friday to kind of review what we were going to present at today's board meeting. And Mr. Kralik said, you know, we really do a lot. And he's right. There are so many beautiful things that we do to help students be comfortable in their schools, to be able to come to us and talk with us about things that might be happening at home. And although there were it was a myriad of different kinds of programs that are presented, they all reflect on the school culture. And the school culture is what impacts students' ability to get along with one another, ability to stand up for students that they see that might be bullied, the ability to stand up for themselves. So in conclusion, I just want to say that you heard about lessons K through 6 and how we move away from that a little bit at the junior high level. Fewer lessons, more application of the lessons, and more targeted support of individual students that need that extra help in either the area of being a victim or the area of being a bully. The school-wide positive behavior support plans are articulated K-12. And then finally, the programs that we utilize to support our caring community K-12 that enhances the school experience for all students. So at that point, are there questions? Yes, Mr. Miller.
I'd just like to make a comment. First of all, I'd like to thank all of you guys for the hard work that you did. Thank you all. What I want to say is that there's a couple things that I don't want to hold everybody up because I know it's getting late. people ask me, they say, why are you really interested in getting back on the school without being there all the year? You guys are the reason, because of the way you treat our kids in this school system. And I want to thank you for the kids, too. And one thing that really impressed me, and I know there's a lot of work and a lot of things up here, but the thing that hit me home the most was that you concentrate on the kindergarten and first and second grade. And I think that's where it's so important. It's kind of tough for us to work with some of the older kids after they're set in their ways. So I felt so good to see those programs you had up there. And I think if we build our kids from an early age, we'll have less bullying later. And like, you're talking about women. Yeah, God knows that. But I think another thing that we should do too is somewhere in here, I can't figure out a fancy word for it, but we all tell our kids to report bullying. If you see it, or you feel it, or if you're part of somebody picking on you, I think we need some kind of a witness protection program where we should reach out to a kid, maybe somewhere along the line, say, yeah, because like we talked about walking to a principal's office, how, you know, that's hard to do, and it's hard for a kid to run in there. So some way, I'd like to see you guys come up with something where you can get across to the kids, hey, come up to me sometime, or talk to me out in the hall, or we're you know, because kids are afraid of retaliation.
They are afraid of retaliation and retribution. I would say that we have students that come forward on behalf of other students, and we have students that come forward on behalf of themselves.
It's a hard thing to
do. It is. And one of the hardest things is to convince students that if you don't come forward, it won't get better. Because you first have to test that out. And a lot of students are afraid of what happens afterwards. And to be truthful, sometimes kids say, well, I knew you were going to tell, you know. But when we follow through with that behavior, things then get better. So you're right, but it is taught, believe me. I'm not sure what the silver bullet is for helping students come forward. If I knew that, I could make a lot of money.
Thank you so much.
Any other questions, comments? Well, thank you for your attention.
I just want to summarize that, to your point, recognize that students are not encouraged to only go to these people. You know, there are staff available, whether it is a teacher, a classroom assistant, a custodian, a food service worker, a parent, a community member. So it is not just the administration and the focus of going into that office, quote unquote. And the culture is that you want students to encourage them to report this type of behavior because of how it makes somebody feel. But it's not only to discipline the student who is bullying, but also to empower the victim as to how they handle it. And it's twofold, and I think that is the message that comes across in Bully Proof Your Schools, and as well as the 7 and 12 program. We know that we are, Dr. Soltis is one of her first statements, we are not going to eradicate Greater Latrobe School District, the community of Greater Latrobe, or the state of Pennsylvania of bullying. By any program, we recognize that. But I believe that in all of the programs that we have put into place, the relationships that our staff and our administrators understand are important with students and with their parents and the community members, that we have created a culture that helps students to report and helps us to deal with these situations. We are not always going to know that a behavior is going on. But we want to encourage everyone to report it so that we at least have an opportunity to do that. But we also recognize that we are not always going to please everyone with the reaction that we take when an incident occurs.
We handle incidents in the manner in which we believe is best fitting the situation, the age of the student, the programs that they have been through. All of those things make a difference in the approach that an administrator or teacher makes regarding certain behaviors and certain things that happen. And we have to trust that those things that we do are altering the behavior. And that is the obvious, ultimate thing that we want to have happen, is that if a student displays a behavior that could be considered bullying or inappropriate or creating conflict, if what we do, what actions we take, change that behavior, that to me is success. And so when we talked about doing this program, I apologize that it is as long as it is, but very clearly they're so multifaceted as far as the things that we approach and how we approach different levels. So if you have any questions, you think of something between now and next week, please, you know, call, email, ask next week. As I said initially to the board, there is the PowerPoint and the presentation has been videoed. Thank you, Zach. And we are going to place it on our website so that if you know anyone who might want to view any of this, please feel free. And we will put it out there so that people can look at it if they have interest. And maybe they can fast forward for certain things they want to. But thank you very much. I appreciate your time. Thank you.
I really thought the presentation was excellent. I'm amazed at everything that goes on in the kindergarten, which is sort of 12th grade. And I thank you for all your time. It's very, very, very good. I think they deserve a round.
Basically, the resolution next week pertains to our new elementary school. It does two basic things. One, it sets out certain minimum costs where we establish what these costs would be. And two, it schedules what is called an Act 34 hearing, which is a required proceeding before we move forward with the project. To that end, there is an Act 34 hearing, which will be scheduled by this resolution on October 10, 2016, 7 o'clock p.m. here at the CTC. And basically, very briefly, what the resolution will do, it will set forth two totals. One is called the maximum building cost, and the other is called the maximum project cost. Putting it very briefly, the maximum building cost is all of the construction costs for our building, plus the architectural and engineering fees. The maximum project cost is really the construction cost plus all the other costs, land acquisition, sewage, site development, grading, and some legal costs. The resolution also schedules the Act 34 hearing, and just so that you're aware, the Act 34 hearing is not a trial, it is not a proceeding like a court proceeding. It is a legislative style hearing. There will be a series of presentations made, followed by public comment and public question and answer. I will be the hearing officer. We'll have a court reporter here. And basically, the agenda will be a series of topics. There will be a welcoming by Dr. Lachman, project history and justification. There will be an architectural presentation by Axis Architecture, cost analysis, and local budget impact report. And then there will be a comment, question, and answer period. And at any time before the hearing and for a certain period of time after the hearing, the board will accept public comments, which are then made part of the record. Once all of this is done, it is all made part of the record and submitted to Harrisburg as part of our submission. So that's what the resolution will do next week. It will set the maximum project cost and the maximum construction cost, and it will schedule the experts.
Are there any questions about that? Okay, in addition to that being on our finance agenda next week, we will have the approval of gifts, grants, and donations. And I would urge you all to take a look, if you haven't already done so, at the combined meeting minutes of the Finance and the Facilities Operations and Planning Committee, which met together on September 7th. And they'll go a long way to explaining the things that Mr. Nagle just talked about and what will be happening at the Act 34 meeting. The next Finance Committee meeting will be held on Wednesday, October 5th at 10 a.m. at the Admin Building. That concludes our report. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Ellen. The next Facilities Operation and Planning Committee meeting will be Thursday, October 6th at 3:30 in the Admin Building. And for student activities, next week we'll approve the winter sports bid. I will announce that girls soccer senior night will be this coming Monday, September 19th at 6:30 in Rossi Field. And Mr. Mayor, if you'd like to briefly let us know how to do
that. Yeah, I told you last meeting that I would have a better idea of what happened after we finished the Kelly Picker concert, because everything was bought in one big lump sum. Everything turned out super. For the school district, we were able to help 17 programs this year, which is the most we've ever been able to assist with funding. We had well over 300 volunteers, like I said before, probably over the two events to help. And the organizations in that gave you your printout to range anywhere from the student council to the band to the sports team to the volunteer fire department that helped us. So I think it was a very busy August, to say the least. But turned out very well for our community, and ESPN was very pleased, the Steelers were very pleased, and I thought we looked pretty good after I watched it on my DVR, and sat down and watched it last week. We were on television for the first time. I thought our stadium looked pretty remarkable too. So I thought, all in all, I thank everyone for their help, and I thought we might be here in August this year. I was quite undertaking, but it was fun. I think the community enjoyed it, and I've heard a lot of talk about it from a lot of people that I wouldn't expect to watch.
In addition to assisting the 17 programs we have, we also, with the remaining money, were able to replace the backboards with mountain view jumps. So.
And back. As I've been just watching Mr. Thomas, they did get back.
Right, so that concludes my report. Community relations, Dr. George.
Next, the Care of Parks and Recreation meeting is Thursday, September 15th.
Parks and Recreation Commission meeting is not going to be in the room of the municipal building. Third Ward Playground, which we just recently remodeled, is fairly finished. And we are going to have our meeting at Third Ward Playground and have a ribbon cutting ceremony there. And that will be at 4:30 on Thursday. So all of you are welcome to attend. The school is requesting that property, so if you're not interested in seeing how it was renovated, please, you're more than welcome. So that would be Thursday.
Okay. Mrs. Hayes,
On your agenda, next week will be a resolution to authorize joint purchasing consortium representative and alternative, and that's in the meeting minutes that Mrs. Calder had talked about. You read those. Also, permission to advertise jointly as a member of the West Orange Community and Joint Purchasing Consortium for 17-18 school year. And the summary of the WIU board meeting minutes for August 23rd are also in the chat. Our next WIU committee meeting will be held on Tuesday, September 27th, at the WIU board. WCTC, Mr. Reed.
Thank you. The next WCTC joint operating committee will be Wednesday, September 28th at 7 p.m. And that will be the WCTC.
Board policy, Mrs. Elder.
Yes, I am going to propose that we put together a ballot for next week's meeting that will appear on our agenda, and we can vote yes or no on that ballot. Because actually, there's only one position that's open, per se, and the others are all sort of a pro forma vote. So the school board association wants a vote from the board rather than no vote from the board. So we'll put together that ballot and have it on the agenda for next week. And there will be a board policy committee meeting on Tuesday, September 27th at 9 a.m. at the admin building. And I'd just like to agree with what Mr. Rasion has said about everything that everybody has done. And, you know, we sit there and we pick apart the policies paragraph by paragraph and put them back together. And it's just amazing to see what the administration and teachers of this school district do with that after we played with it. Thank you all very, very much.
So our technology, Mr. Connor?
Dr. Walker, we have our technology meeting tonight with, here at CSC at 6. Meeting notes will be attached to our next school board meeting. And our next meeting is Tuesday, December 20th. At 6 p.m. here at CSC. Thank you all.
Superintendent's recommendations.
Move it out to board next week to approve some resignations. Notably, there is an associate who is retiring from Cunningham, who has served the district for many years. In addition, we would ask the board to add to our substitute teacher list the names and certifications are listed. Also approve support personnel appointments as listed, as well as the supplemental personnel appointments for the co-weight training assistants, the girls assistant grade 7 basketball, and the girls assistant basketball coach. In addition, we would add one additional AmeriCorps personnel to our program in our high school. Under other business, this Thursday is our junior high school open house. Last week was our senior high school, and as well as the students mentioned, this Friday, September 16th, is band night, and our junior high school students will be included in the marching band. Our regular committee of the whole meetings are listed there for next week, as well as October, and the second meeting in October is the